Now we know that how to put the data into HDFS. So we at least know one way to get the data into Hadoop distributed file system, that is Hadoop FS minus put. Okay. So you will upload the data from your local file system into Hadoop distributed file system, and it can be, you know, uploaded from any machine in your cluster. Okay. So because everyone is having Hadoop client installed, so from there, whichever data that is in the local file system of any node can be uploaded into Hadoop distributed file system. So once you get the data into Hadoop distributed file system, now the second thing that you should know is that what to do with it. Okay. So getting the data, working with the Hadoop distributed file system, getting we are all clear like about the writing process, reading process, okay, and how does it affect the HDFS overall. So once you get the data into it, what we will do, now we need to understand it. So basically, once we get the data, we need to analyze it. Analyze in terms of, you know, there could be a lot of types of analysis. Basically, you can, you know, do some kind of aggregation, you can do some kind of summation, you can do some kind of, you know, filtering, ordering, sorting of the data. Okay. So just like if you get some sale data, then you may need to write some queries, you may need to write some analytics on the top of it, so that it will tell you that on each month basically how much sale you have done. Okay. Your business may also want to see some graphs, some charts on the sales on quarterly basis or monthly basis or semi-monthly basis, whatever, daily basis even, okay, on region wise, on a, you know, region or like the geography wise, there could be multiple things that may be done. Then again, currently we are just seeing text data, but then it could be binary data, image data, sensor data. There could be a lot of formats that you will see into, you know, your HDFS. ORC data, Evro data, sequence data, binary data, okay, then Parquet data. So there could be multiple formats, multiple compressions on each format, okay. So it could be a very, you know, kind of complex data that you may get. Okay, it would be complete, you know, video data, and you may need to do some kind of phase detection, you may need to do some kind of, you know, traffic congestion kind of thing. So suppose if it is a traffic data, it means that there is a live camera on any square, and then it is actually monitoring the traffic over there. It will keep streaming the complete, you know, that video data into your Hadoop distributed file system, that you may need to continuously do some kind of stream analysis on the top of it and just check whether you will get some traffic congestion on how many squares, and then generate some traffic alerts in that area. Okay, so that all possible things. Then you may need to get some all banking stuff, kind of all transaction data that you may need to, you may stream it, and then kind of detect some frauds, okay, whenever it is getting made, right? So there are a lot of ways, lot of scenarios, lot of use cases that you will see in Hadoop. Okay, so again, when you talk about Hadoop, basically still most of like Hive, Pig, some Java MapReduce still uses MapReduce framework. Okay, and MapReduce framework is again like it got invented by Doug Cutting when he was writing the Hadoop distributed file system. So he wrote HDFS as well as the MapReduce framework also in order to do the analytics. Okay, so today in this session, basically, we will try to understand the Hadoop MapReduce framework. Okay, and first we will discuss it quite deeply, that what are all the different components of Hadoop MapReduce framework, okay, why it is so famous, you know, how it is distributedly doing the analytics on, because the thing is, when you talk about Hadoop distributed file system, the data is not on one place. Okay, so if you are having one big file, let's say 10 GB of file, and if you are having the block size of 128 MB or two, whatever, then it could be like thousands of blocks you will get out of that file, and each block will be stored in three copies in three different nodes. Okay, it means that you will not find the data on any one machine for that whole file. Okay, that whole file is broken into the blocks, and each block may be scattered. Okay, and those blocks are scattered into your file system. It is completely distributed. You will not get the data on same machine. Okay, so it means that if you want to do the analytics on that file, you will go to each machine and try to collect its block, and then do the analytics of each block, and then collate your result finally in order to give you the final result. So let's say, suppose if I want to do a count or summation of the sale data, and you know that the sale data is scattered. So you need to do the summation on each block level, and then finally you will sum all the result somewhere. Okay, so that you will give the final output. Okay, so some kind of, you know, so that logic we need to understand, that how it is designed, how it is efficient in order to perform this kind of distributed analytics on the distributed data. So, okay, so this is the picture I have drawn, and it is like, you know, the complete end-to-end MapReduce workflow, okay, in a single snap, okay, that will actually, you know, try to allow you, try to, you know, make you think in a single picture that how the things are going. Okay, so we will discuss this, try to, you know, create or try to, you know, talk about the jargons of MapReduce, that what are all the different bits and pieces of MapReduce, how they are, you know, integrated with each other in order to give you the complete MapReduce flow. Okay, now map and reduce, basically these two things are like two words, map and reduce. So map is basically, you know, terminology where each blocks are going to be, you know, analyzed. It will generate some intermediate result, because the thing is, if you just analyze only one block, it would not be the final result. Okay, until unless if you don't analyze all the blocks of that file, you cannot come to any conclusion, right? It's quite obvious that if one file is having 10 GB of data and it's stored distributedly, and if you want to do some kind of aggregation on the file level, you know, you need to read each of its block, come up with some intermediate result by applying some algorithm on that block, and then finally all that intermediate result will be, you know, again analyzed or processed in order to give you the final result. Okay, so it is broken into pieces. So first it will be a map phase, in which you will read each individual block of that file, try to, you know, work with the each individual block's data, come up with certain results, then finally those results will be again processed in order to give you the final result, okay, on the file level. So reduce is that part. So one is map phase, in which you will read individual block. Another is reduce phase, in which you will, you know, in which you will process all the intermediate data coming out of all the map tasks. Okay, so this is how it looks like. So we have one file, let's say this is the file. Okay, this file is memon.txt. So we have just say Hadoop fs minus put memon.txt into some directory. Okay, now this file is having four blocks: block 1, block 2, block 3, and block 4. Okay, in block 1 we have this data: abc, abd, ef, daef, something like this. Okay, so these are like set of characters. Okay, though this data seems very small and it could not even fit a single block, but then again, just for understanding the overall MapReduce framework, we just need to assume that, okay, this is a single block of this file, because it means that this particular is the data from memon.txt, that is from this file. But when we actually have put it into HDFS, since it will be split into blocks, so there would be four blocks that is pertaining to this memon.txt, and each block is having the data like this. Okay, so we have this file, we have its blocks is stored in HDFS, and we just need to assume that each block, like block 1, is present in three different data nodes, block 2 is also present in three different data nodes, block 3 is also present, and block 4 also present in three different data nodes, right? So this is the HDFS picture, we are clear on it. Now there are classes, or basically when we talk about MapReduce, we need to talk something bit of Java. We already understood Java, that what is the class, what is object, okay, and what is map collection, what is list collection, and now we are going to implement that understanding over here. So what happened is, the smallest unit of MapReduce, okay, or the smallest unit of data basically that MapReduce processes, is said to be a input split. Okay, now this is where we need to understand the relation between a block, that is the smallest unit of HDFS, and input split, that is over here, that this is the input split, that is the smallest unit of the MapReduce. or this knowledge is made of data that map reduce processes. Okay, in 99% cases, the block and the input split will be equal. Okay, in some of the cases, the input split may be bigger than the block size. Okay, it can never be smaller than a block. Okay, I mean, that is something that is not possible, because the smallest unit of data, if that the smallest unit of data needs to be, that is a block of HDFS needs to be processed by one map task, that is the smallest unit of input split. Okay, it cannot be lower than that. So in the relation between the input split, that is the smallest unit of data being processed by a map reduce, and the smallest unit of HDFS called a block, is that input split is equal to or greater than the block size of your HDFS. But in 99% cases, it is equal to the block size. Okay, so in this whole discussion, we will just assume that the input split over here is equal to the block that we are going to process. So it means that if we do four blocks, we have four maps. Okay, because each of these blocks, okay, may is stored on different machines. Even if it is the same machine, okay, or same data node, if two blocks are there, but still we require one particular program to go there to that block, read all the data, and do some kind of processing to it. Okay, so in this whole MapReduce flow, our intention is to count at how many times each letter appears in this whole text called memand.txt. So we can easily count manually over here, like A appears 1, A appears 2, so 2A, then 3A, then 4A, then 5A, and so on. Okay, then we need to count that how many times B appears, how many times C appears, how many times D appears, and so on. Okay, so that is our intention. But then again, this data is distributed. Okay, now this map 1 may run on data node 1, so I will write it over here, DN1. This map 2, so this map, when I say map 1, map 2, these are Java programs. Okay, Java programs with their individual JVM, Java Virtual Machine. Okay, this map 1 is an individual JVM, you can say, which will just read the data, get it into the RAM, and try to process it and emit some results, and then once it is finished, it will go off. That's it. Okay, so map, whatever is here, map 1, it is just a simple Java program with its own JVM. It means that this map 1 and map 2, they never talk to each other. They are completely independent of each other. Okay, they never communicate. It means they are embarrassingly parallel processes. Each of these map tasks are embarrassingly parallel. It means that they run on their own individually. Okay, if they fail, they fail. That is that they will not hamper any other map task running in some other node or even on the same node. Suppose if this map 1 and map 2, they might run on the same node, no issues. But if something has happened to map 1, if it fails due to some error, only map 1 will be affected, map 2 will not be affected. Are you getting me? So all these map tasks, all these map 1, map 2, map 3, map 4, they are embarrassingly parallel processes. They will process only the data corresponding to their block, whatever they are reading. Okay, so now I am saying that this block 1 is, let's say, being read by this data node, this map 1 on data node 1. Okay, so this input split over here, that is the first thing, SPLIT split, is actually equal to this block, and it will read all the data from this block 1. Okay, there is something called record reader. Okay, so this is a class. Again, when I say READER over here, it is said to be a record reader. That is a class, okay, that is responsible in order to convert the data into key value pairs. Okay, now when I say that map 1 is reading the data, map 1 or any map task will read the data in terms of key value pairs. Okay, starting from the map towards the end of the reduce phase, everything will be key value pair. Okay, this is, you just need to burn this into your mind. Okay, map reduce complete flow from end to end will be done only in key value pairs fashion. Okay, everything, every record, every data is in key value pair. Okay, so this record reader, the record reader responsibility is to convert any data that it is getting into input split. Okay, it will convert that into key value pairs and will give that input to the map one. So if you see here, how this record reader will convert this particular data into key value pair. So again, I will let you know. Basically, this is just simple text document. Okay, if you see this, it is just dot text, Mimon dot text, right? So if you can open it. So how any text looks like? So let me just clear this. So go to this notepad. This is a text document. I will have some lines over here. How are you? I will say I am fine. Thank you. How are you? I am also fine. Thank you. Now suppose this is the data that will be there in the input split. Okay. Now the record reader needs to convert this data into key value pair. Okay, so that it can be given into the input to this map task. Okay. And then map task, once it will get the key value pair, it will again generate some more key value pairs out of that. Okay. Until end, you will find only key value pairs. Okay. So let me just tell you how this particular thing is going to be converted into key value pair. So any record reader, what it will do is basically it will open the document. It will read this first line. Hi, how are you? Okay. And then it will take the offset of this particular line. That is the first line. So the offset of this first line is zero. Offset means the starting position of first line. Okay. So it will convert that offset to be the key that is starting from zero. And this whole line is your value for that particular zero. So I will say, hi, how are you? Okay. So that hi, how are you, everything comes over here as a value. So this is your first key value pair, okay, generated by your record reader. So it will also then sum up all this the position. So it will start with zero, then h comes on one, I come on two, space come on three, h come on four, zero, o come on five, like so it will count. So let's say over here the total sum of characters would be around, let's say, 15. Okay, so the next offset of the second line would be 16. Okay, so it will start with next offset of the line, that is start on 16, and it will then read I am fine, thank you as a complete value for this particular. So it is a kind of map. Are you getting me? In map collection in Java, basically we have key value pairs, right? And this is what a record reader will do. It will convert everything in this document, okay, every line in this document to be a key value pair. Key is the offset of your document on that line, and the complete line is your value. Okay, and this is how mostly, like, and this is the default format of MapReduce, called text input format. It means that if you don't specify anything, it will be considered as text. And believe me, most of the times, 80% of the times, you will always handle only text data. Okay, no matter it is a tab separated or comma separated or any other separator in the data, but mostly you will handle the text data. Okay, and text data means it can be easily converted into this fashion. So it is like I treated to be a text document where the key is the offset of each line. It offset means a starting position of that line. Okay, so every line's starting position is dependent on that how many number of characters you have in previous line. So if it is 15, then the offset would be taken as 16 for this line. Okay, then suppose from 16 you will go up to, let's say, over here 32, total 16 characters in second line. So the third line offset will be 33, and then whole line is your value. Okay, so every line will be converted like this. Okay, this is how a text document is going to be converted into key value pair by the record reader class. Okay, and this particular data is from one input split. Okay, and for every input split or for every block, the record reader will do conversion of the lines into key value pairs, okay, where the key is offset value and the value is complete line. Okay, so this key value is treated to be a map, right? This is our map collection, nothing else. Are you getting me? And that's why the map and list collections in Java is very important for understanding MapReduce. So when you come here in this particular diagram, you will see that the input is split. It will read the first block called block 1. This record reader will read this particular line and convert it into key value pair. And that key value pair is going to be passed to this map 1. And what it will do? So basically what record reader has given this map 1 is, since we are considering this to be a complete one line only in that document, so it will like say 0 and all these characters come as a value. Okay, so all these characters will come as a value and it will be given to this map 1. And now this map 1 will start working with that key value pairs. Okay, where it will just ignore that key because we are more interested in value part of that map, because that value is having the actual data, okay, to which we will work with. Okay, but again it is only for this particular scenario where we are giving the importance to the value only, because that value is having all the data which we want to process. But in different scenario, key also will be processed like anything, because it is data. I mean, key and value pairs, it is either this map task will use key to be the prime data or value to be the prime data, or both of them combination to be the prime data. Okay, it depends on different scenarios. Currently in our scenario, we are more interested in just counting the number of characters, how many times they appear in this file. Or so if we want to collate the complete result on the file level, we may need to go on each individual block, try to get the numbers of characters appearing in that block, and then combine them later on with other blocks also, the result from other blocks, right? And we will then get the results on file level. So input is split is equal to one block. This record reader has converted that particular line of characters into key value pairs, where key is this offset and value is the complete line. And now what map will do? Map will emit a constant one for each of these characters. So first of all, if you see, there is a space delimiter in each of this line. Okay, so we have a space here, 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 and in every character we do have, between every two characters we do have one space. So we need to write a logic, or you know, so again, this map one is a Java program, and if it is a Java program, then there must be some Java written into it, right? So Java logic written into it. And the Java logic, we will see this completely, I mean, when we actually start practicing. So we will get this same data, we will see how we will write this map one program. Okay, so while writing the program, basically what we'll do is, we need to sum them up, or we need to count the number of times each character is appearing. Okay, so the logic is that for every character, let that line to be space delimited. Okay, so you will just read this line, the complete, and then make it split delimited and put it into an array, okay, or put it into any kind of collection of or other list or whatever. You just need to get them, each one of them, out of this particular line. So A should be like kind of a standalone character, B then standalone character, C standalone character, then A again standalone character, kind of thing. Okay, so you get this line, you make it, you will just make it split on space, and while splitting you will get this individual character and put a one with it. Okay, so again, this is a key value pair, right? This is again a key value pair, this is again a key value pair. So that's what I'm saying, right? Starting from the record reader, I mean, record reader will convert the data into key value pair, given to it will give that to map task. Map task will work, and in its entire lifetime, the map task will work only with the key value pairs. So he has got the key value pair as input, and again will generate some key value pair as output. And what is output? A comma 1, this is one key value pair. B comma 1 is this, again one key value pair. C comma 1, then again A comma 1, B comma 1, D comma 1. So if you see this A, that is A comma 1, B comma 1, C comma 1, then A comma 1, B comma 1, D comma 1. then E comma 1, F comma 1, D comma 1. Who is generating this? Again, a Java program, that is the logic written into this map task or this map program. You'll see that later. But basically, what we are trying to achieve is, if we generate the key value pairs like that, okay, then by some means, we will group them by the character, okay, and list and sum up all the values for that particular character. So if I say group by A, so it will come like all the A, and then its corresponding one will be on the same place, okay, and then we will just sum up 1 plus 1, okay, plus 1. So we can see that the A appears 3 times over here in this particular block. Okay, that's why we keep generating one for every character. Later on, we will sum all the ones for each character group by its own, you know, group by that character. Okay, just like kind of a Hive query or sorry, SQL query, group by. We can group by A and count all the ones for that A, we will get the count for A. Similarly can be done for B, similarly can be done for C and so on. So the map task is generating the data like this, okay? It will read the data in key value fashion and generating key value pairs. Now, what happens is basically this map one is a JVM. Okay, JVM means it should have a heap in which it actually has all this data. Okay, but then the size of this heap, okay, is mostly 100 MB. I mean, again, the size of this heap can be planned by your administrator. He can give some value to that whenever this JVM will be created for map task, what would be the size of, you know, RAM that can be given to it. Okay, that is called sort.io. Sort.io is a property for MapReduce which you can just provide that how much MB it should be. Okay, now what happens is there is one more property that will is called the purging, not purging basically, but basically, you know, if your RAM fills 80% of its size. Okay, so let's say suppose if it is 100 MB given, so 80 MB is 80% of 100 MB, right? So if it fills around 80 MB of size, okay, it means that your map, and still there are a lot of data to be processed by this map task, it means that you may go out of heap space memory error if you keep filling this RAM with more and more data you are processing, right? Because reserve infinite size of your RAM. Okay, you need to be fixed it with some value, and then once it fills around 80% of size, it needs to be, you know, spilled onto the buffer, or not buffer, basically it's spilled onto the disk. It means that you need to offload some data from this RAM and write into some temporary local file system, and that is where your hard disk, I mean, so let's say this is data node 1, I will say this is data node 1. So the data node 1's local hard disk will be used in order to store the data if it fills around 80% of its size. It means that we need to avoid any heap out of space error, otherwise we can never conclude anything out of this map one program, right? Because if you will get heap out of space, you need to restart the thing, and then again you will get heap out of space error. It is just runtime error that we need to avoid. Okay, so to avoid that, basically we know that if it never reached to 80%, and prior to that only your map task finishes and it processes all the data, it's always good. But then most of the times what will happen is it can, you know, do some, you know, processing lot of data, because it is like one to many, many to one, one to one combination. Okay, so let's assume that when it processes this first two line, it has generated two spills. One is over here and one is over here. These spills are on your local hard disk of your data node one over here, right? So this is what is called buffer. This buffer is like almost 100 MB, and this is mostly the size of your, you know, heap space of your map task or map program, you can say, you know. So this buffer is just like heap space, and we are trying to avoid make it full, okay, otherwise it will be out of space error. So if it fills around 80% of its size, all the data will be spilled onto the hard disk. It means that it will temporarily be stored on the hard disk. Later on, it will be transferred to somewhere else. Okay, and then more data will come into it and then will get processed. So let's say this next set of two lines will come and will be processed. So we will get two spills, spill one and spill two. Okay, so this is how actually it will spill out onto the disk. Okay, any questions of now?